Staff report on public schools, board report.
Yes, Madam Chair, I believe we have.
What you have in your package is pretty much in keeping with normal reporting that we get from Corporation Public Schools. You have your first quarter funding request, as well as a expenditure and revenue summary following that. And the way the pack, the way the funding request is put forward, RBS requests 1/4 of their annual allotment each quarter. So the amount that we actually allow to them is in keeping with that percentage, not necessarily reflective of what they have spent, it's just a funding request. The next report is how fund function summary is expenditures and revenues for the first quarter. It has actual amounts that were expended and received during the first 3 months of the fiscal year. The numbers obviously are not for the full year's amount. However, we did ask RBS if there were any variances that were material or any concern, and they said things were pretty much on track. It's just no first score.
Okay. Thank you. One of the things that I
Wanted
to request from the staff and the committee's been in the discussion is that we also ask schools if they would just provide us with a more maybe 6 month report on the CIP funds and funds for maintenance so that we can have some sense of where they are on the actual expenditures and the receiving of funding for CIP projects.
You will make that request.
And with that, Madam Clerk, we will move to the papers for consideration, starting with number one.
Okay. Item number one, ordinance number 25-64, to amend the city code for the purpose of requiring council's approval of a resolution for construction and professional services contract with a value greater than $100,000 for all contract modifications and increase the contract by 15%. $25,000,
whichever is greater. Mr. Powell? You want to talk about this? Thank you. Well, this one's been on the books for quite a while, and I know we've had a chance to talk about it a little bit, but from a public standpoint, I just believe as council it's important for us to have a better understanding of all the contracts that are out there. A little bit later in this presentation, and during this meeting, we'll have a very serious presentation about dollars and cents. And unfortunately, we don't have a lot of that information at our fingertips on a regular basis. And with having this type of paper in place, we would in fact be getting this information on a regular basis. So my recommendation is to move forward, and I would hope the community can see it that way.
Is there anyone here who would like to speak in favor of this paper? Hearing none, anyone here who would like to speak in opposition? And I'll bring this paper back to the committee.
All right. Discussion?
Chair?
Mr. Samuels.
I had originally thought this paper made a lot of sense, but in doing my due diligence, I sat down with the Observance Greater Richmond Chamber of Commerce. the Metropolitan Business League and talked to a lot of businesses that do business with the city. And the unanimous comment I received from them was that this is going to hurt their ability to do business with the city and put the city even further behind in its reputation for being business friendly, especially working with folks. That being the case, and speaking with the administration, I'm not supporting this paper, but I am working with the administration and hopefully this committee to bring forward regular and timely reports on contracts as they are occurring so that we are in a position to have that oversight. Enrico kind of split the baby. Enrico does it by an expedited resolution to approve these, which as far as I can recall, do not carry the weight of law in Enrico, and provide zero possibility for public input. They're introduced, expedited, and voted on the same night. And that just doesn't suit what we need with a paper like this, which is to make the public aware and also make sure the public has a chance to comment on it before we vote for it. So at that point, I think what I'd really like to do is work with the administration so that in the coming year, we will be getting regular reports, timely reports, about exactly the things laid out in this paper. That seems to be a solution that maintains our friendliness to businesses and our ease of working with businesses, still provides us with the oversight, and doesn't damage our reputation.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You know, Mr. Samuels, I appreciate what you're saying, but I'm sitting here, and we have four major projects going on right now. The Justice Center, Broad Rock Elementary, Broad Rock, Oak Grove Elementary, MLK, which is a little bit further down, not as far down the road as you got, which actually makes five. We've not seen one updated report on these projects since the day they broke ground. I have asked the administration on numerous occasions to provide this information, and as we go through dialogue later on today, I'm going to be asking for that information again, particularly with regards to the bonds. It's unfortunate, but we are left in the dark. We're not provided this information in a timely manner, and we're sitting up here getting ready to make major financial decisions. We do not have the first shred of paper that shows us where we are from a financial perspective. This paper is about forcing that issue because until we do it, nothing's going to change. So I respect what you're saying, but disagree with the whole part of it.
This paper has been continued for, I think it was introduced for a long time. We've continued this paper for quite some time. One of the concerns that I've always had with this paper, I really respect the fact that we should, and I've had quite a bit of discussion about procurement, and procurement has brought us reports since that time, so I think that there has to we already have a commitment from procurement as to a frequency of reports that are going to be presented to us. We have already received some report to that effect as well. So there is not an absence of reports as it relates to that, and a commitment on behalf of the administration as it relates to those reports. If we feel that we need to revise those reports or ask for any additional information, they've been very welcome and encouraging of that. Secondly, I think that we have also, I know we all get a status report on all of these major projects or that are under construction at the present time. The administration is sending us copies of those progress report on a very regular and frequent basis. If we need to have those reports brought to the committee, so that it is documented in the as part of the financial committee's reporting on the progress of all of those reports, I think that we should do so because we certainly do not want to suggest that there is no reporting on projects that have been, expedited, I mean, that have been executed and that are in the process of being done. So both of those situations have been agreed to by the administration to provide us with a list of contracts, contracts that are out of bid, the status of those contracts, the awarding of those contracts, the amount of the awards of those contracts, as well as PBE has agreed that they would provide information on the MBE and small business participation in those contracts. Those things have been approved and are in process by the administration currently. We should continue, I don't know that there's a formal process that you've agreed to as far as reports, but I do know that we are receiving reports from those that have been executed. My concern with this paper is that, as Mr. Samuels said, it is, whereas we reviewed surrounding counties' papers were not open for public discussion, which is understandable to some degree. But likewise, when I look at the due diligence of this council and their role as it relates to how much scrutinizing we need to do and how much review we want to do before we approve a contract, the challenge that the industry has said with that level of involvement by the council of reviewing the contract before we feel comfortable in saying it is going to add significant time to the contract, and I believe that to be true, to the contracting process. We have currently a minority firm that has filed suit against the city in regards to whether or not they felt that the procurement process was handled correctly and so forth and so on. I don't want the responsibility of whether or not, because I'm not going to, I don't think that we're in a position to do that kind of contract review before I go on approval of a contract. I think the administration needs to take that responsibility for the total review of these contracts and make the recommendation that council's approval of appropriation of contracts and then follow up report and so forth. So I'm not going to support this paper, and there is also a companion paper that goes along with this. Mr. Clerk, is that correct? I don't know what number that is.
Madam Chair, I believe it's item number 13.
Number 13. So I'd like to call that. If I could get a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Move forward to council with recommendations, Chair. Before.
Madam Chair, before we do that, I agree with a lot of what you said, but I want to further point out, Mr. Marshall does provide us reports. You're absolutely correct. But those reports are status reports. They don't give us, there are two things included in it. One, they show the amount of time, that is where the project is in time, and then they kind of give an overall discussion about what's coming up in terms of each one of the projects, where it is, like design team, construction administration for primary construction, phase three, I mean, and they kind of go into those kind of things. But none of the reports that Mr. Marshall has provided us are financial. We don't get financial updates on these schools. So that's why I've been passionate about this. I respect y'all's opinion, and I assume we'll have 2-1 vote. We need to move on.
And what I would say in response to that, Mr. Talbot, is that if we want to monitor the actual expenditures, then I think we should ask for that as well. But we can take that into investment. Okay, we have a motion, I'll second the motion to.
Over to council with recommendations.
Point of order.
Mr. Clerk. We have a motion on the table, would you expedite the businesses at hand?
Yes, Madam Chair, we have a motion from Mr. Samuels to move forward, to move this paper forward to council with the recommendation to strike.
Madam Chair, point of order, public hearing on item 13.
We have to call the paper up here, sir.
I thought you were combining the papers and voting on both of them.
No, we only voted on the paper that's before us, thank you very much.
Number one, ordinance number 22-64. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
All right, thank you very much, Mr. Clerk, appreciate that.
Okay, we have two in favor and one opposed. Okay, that paper will now move forward to council with the recommendation to strike.
If we can call it number 13, and following 13, if we can proceed the paper in the order that it presented on the document.
Okay. Next, we have item number 13, resolution number 2012-R43. To amend rules and procedure for the city council adopted by resolution number 2009-R1-1, adopted January 2nd, 2009, for the purpose of providing an expedited process for the review of resolutions approving certain contracts.
Discussion? Public hearing? All those in favor, is there anyone in the public who would like to speak?
Yes, is there anyone in the public who would like to speak in favor, Mr. Chair? Is there anyone in the public who would like to, who is opposed to this paper?
Good afternoon, my name is Silver Persinger. I'm neither speaking in support or opposition of this paper. I'm a little troubled by the discussion. I have to admit my ignorance of both of these papers that are just been considered by the council. However, I tend to agree with Mr. Tyler that more financial information is required of the council by the administration. And, you know, I don't know, I was actually trying to catch up on the Style article magazine about the Redskins to inform my opinion about that paper, but you know, I'm troubled by our city's government. It's the deep reverence it pays to the business community. You know, this is a government of the people, and look at this audience. You know, I counted that there were 30-some people in here. I don't know everyone in here, but, you know, 90 or 95% of the people in here work for the city of Richmond. And, you know, it's just disgusting to me that you all make these decisions when the majority of people are at work and unable to attend these meetings. You saw the public come out at Monday's meeting to speak in opposition to Redskins. They people want to keep the school.
Mr. Persinger.
Yes, ma'am.
I appreciate your comments. If you can speak to this paper, that would be helpful.
All right, well, you know, I don't like how this is, the business is being conducted here. It's being done behind the backs of citizens. These meetings aren't televised, they're not even recorded, other than the recording that I provide to the public at great personal expense and labor. You know, you're supposed to represent the people of Richmond, and they're not even here. It's very upsetting and distressing to me. Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Mr. Clerk, we have a budget here. Would you mind saying that again?
Yeah, thank you.
this.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Okay, we have two ayes and one no. The paper will be moved forward to City Council with the recommendation to strike.
Agenda item number various paper here that is in regards to in Brightville Enterprise Zone. What's the number of papers asking Mr. Friend and the audience willing to hold these guys up for the other discussion? Can we call that paper up?
Yes.
First, next, Mr. Chair. We need to clarify, I'm sorry.
Yes, Madam Chair. That's item number 15. Resolution number 2012-R146 to express support for the request by the County of Enrico that the Virginia Department of Housing and Community Development approves its application to amend its portion of Zone 3, formerly known as North Enterprise Zone, and to authorize the CAO to execute the joint amendment agreement indicating the city's support for the county's application.
Madam Vice President, members of City Council, this is an application or request for a resolution by Enrico County to support an amendment to their zone, which is a joint zone called Zone Number 3. They are tied to our zone since 2003, since they were created, and every amendment that happens to anything like the North Zone or Zone 3 has to be supported by the other county versions. Any questions?
Excuse me, Madam Chair, can you please state your name?
Elizabeth Coker, Non Community Development Side.
Thank you.
Questions?
Okay, we'll now have a public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who would like to speak in favor of this paper?
Good afternoon, Madam Chairman. I'm David Sachs. I'm the Community Development Manager with Enrico County. I really can't add anything to what Ms. Coker said, but she's absolutely correct. This is a joint enterprise zone, so any requests and modifications that Enrico County requests must also be approved by Richmond City Council. Likewise, any modifications to the zone boundaries that Richmond City Council requests has to be approved by Enrico County. And in respect for your time, I don't make a presentation, but I think I'd rather just be here to answer any questions that others in the community might have.
Any questions? Thank you, Mr. Sachs.
Thank you.
It's good seeing you. Standing is from the patron, your paper is just standing is number 3.
Next, we have item number four on the agenda, ordinance. Now, we, in this case, we have four related papers. Item number four, eight, nine, ten, actually it's five, four, eight, nine, ten,